Welcome to the Cape Elizabeth School Board Regular Business Meeting on Tuesday, February 14th, 2017. Please join me in the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Before we begin tonight's agenda, I would like to publicly thank all of our Public Works crew members. They have been working nonstop, and they've continued to create a safe environment for our community and schools, and I thank them from the bottom of my heart. The board thanks you. The school department thanks you. We appreciate the long hours and the hard work that you put in. Other board members wanted to join in?
So I'd just like to add, this is one of those things that often goes overlooked, because when you do your job really well, no one notices. We want to let you know that we notice and we thank you.
So thank you to Public Works. Moving on, we're going to start with item one, adjustments to the agenda. Are there any adjustments to tonight's agenda? Seeing none. Moving on to item two, may I have a motion, please?
I move that we approve the school board minutes under agenda item two, A, B, C, and D.
A second.
Any discussion? All those in favor? Thank you. Item three, comments by student representatives. The floor is yours.
So school's been going really great since the last school board meeting. Definitely as we're approaching the February break, the stress levels are a little high. There are a lot of teachers trying to get in one last test before vacation. But outside of school, a lot of our extracurricular activities are doing amazing. The girls' basketball team got their first game. One, for the whole season, so that's great. Aside from that, the Model UN team did really well, and debate states went really well. And altogether, it's been a pretty great month so far.
Yeah. Thank you. Any questions? Please go home and study.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Item number four, comments from the public on agenda items. Seeing none. Moving on to item five, communications. CIP Efficiency Main Lighting Grant. Is that, we'll start with Howard or Greg or, I don't. Is Greg gonna talk about this?
Regarding are you on five now?
Mm-hmm.
Yes. Greg's going to speak to this point.
Okay.
Good evening. We've been recently given an opportunity to partake in a program that Efficiency Maine has for K-12 classroom lighting upgrades. It is a short window type of program, and it allows us to cover about 50% of the costs of an installation of lighting to classrooms for LED. So converting from the fluorescence to an LED. We've been able to put together to do the high school itself. It's about a $104,000 project, and we have some savings that we have had from our capital improvement projects that we've been doing this last year. And what I'd like to do is take $50,000, approximately $54,000 of that, and apply it to this program so we can get that 50% grant and get $104,000 worth of lighting upgrades at the high school. It's about 500 plus fixtures that we'd be looking to update.
You may speak to this.
Please.
And did I hear you say that within about 7 years, we would actually, it would pay off?
Correct. It's a quick payback.
And can you explain to the public when this is happening, if it's affecting the school day or?
We actually have to deliver the application tomorrow if it's approved tonight. The deadline is actually the 17th, but it has to be a hand-delivered document. It is for immediate approval, and all of the work has to be done by April 21st.
Right, so when will
So it's a very, very short window.
Will it disrupt classroom and student learning time?
The way we've planned it is the work's going to be done at night and during school vacation.
Thank you.
Please.
And I believe that Principal Jeff Shedd, this would all be done at your school, that you are, I believe, said that you're fully in support of this.
We have an action item later on in the agenda to actually vote on this, so this is just Greg giving us background.
Thank you. So, may I speak a moment about the other issue here about the playground?
Please.
You all know that a couple of years ago, parents and school personnel came together and were talking about upgrading the playground at Pond Cove. And they worked with a couple of landscape designers, people who specialize in outdoor play structures, promoting good environment, good exercise activity, and just kind of unstructured opportunities for activity. And that plan has been around for at least a year or two. And we recently had a meeting, and Heather was there, and maybe you want to speak to this, Heather, but we had a meeting, and why don't I just let you, would you care to speak to this?
Yeah. Are you referring to the meeting on Friday?
The meeting that we had last week at Pond Cove with the two architects, and Greg and Kelly and Aaron was there as well.
Yep. Well, we had a meeting with the two architects that had created a plan several years ago, and they described the basic needs that have been requested for redoing the playground, and they've created an overhaul of the entire plan, but they also have broken it down with potential places to do it in phases so that it would not be all done at once, but it would be done in various phases. It's been a very thorough job of planning it, and what more were you?
Well, that's probably plenty. We realized that the cost of this project is considerable. It's several hundred thousand dollars, and there are. But we were reassured the project could be done in phases. It doesn't all have to be done at once. Not only Greg has roughly $100,000, he says, in unspent funds through savings on other projects this year. 50 of it would be going again for the lighting. What you should know is that those of us that met feel that plan is a good plan, very good plan, and that according to the people that designed it, for the other $50,000 that Greg has in CIP, he could definitely make headway on the first stage of this, which would be to, I believe, remove some of the playground structures that are currently there at school and turn that mostly into a grass and open field area, and to remove some of the swings that are potentially just dangerous. And so what we will be asking would be for you to consider applying the other 50,000 toward the playground, knowing that it's only going to take us just so far. But the feeling is that in future CIP budgets, more money can be allocated to complete the project, and with your blessing, because the project is really its design, it's a complete package. If individuals in the community or groups wanted to contribute to purchasing certain parts of that, certain trees, certain granite rocks, certain slides, whatever, that it would just augment and move the project along more quickly. So, but again, that would only happen with your blessing. So I think that's the other point.
I'd like to add to that and just clarify that with that $50,000, only so much of the final plan can be implemented, but there is clarity about what to do next. There is a final idea, a final plan in mind, and so it's not haphazard at all. It's very well thought out, it's very planned, and that some of, aside from the swings, some of the structures, they may be up to code right now, but they're towards the end of their lifespan, and so it is in the nearby future that this will be facing us.
May I add that March 2nd, I'm actually meeting with the architect to work on what that $50,000 could do.
And she had alluded to it could get us a good start.
Yep.
On Friday.
Yep.
When we spoke. So.
Question. Could you just add a little color as to, it's like, we have a lot of different things that we're working on facilities-wise, just, and I'm sure that this is something you consider, but just a little commentary on how this fits into what our priorities are for buildings and grounds.
Yeah. Well, that's a very fair question. I don't think that I'm prepared to answer that question tonight. I would hope that Greg will present us with his recommendation on priorities for next year's CIP as part of the budget process. I learned recently that the communication system at Pond Cove and the middle school are not in step. That it's possible to make an announcement, say a fire alarm at the middle school, and not have that announced in the same building at Pond Cove. And so they could be having school going on at one school and evacuating at another. That's apparently, according to Greg, a very outdated system. And I think in terms of getting back to your word priority, issues like communication and ability to notify people to get out of a building if they need to or to lock down is high, high priority. And so if we have this problem and it's outdated, that quickly comes to, it quickly rises to the top. I didn't even know about this until last week. So I'm looking forward to hearing what is in this proposed budget for next year from Greg, and then we can hopefully that help answer the question. I mean, he's closer to it than anybody.
I'm sorry, I didn't hear what you said.
You're closer to all of those needs than anybody else.
Yes.
The piece we're discussing now has to do with the existing approved budget and reallocations amongst it. So I
right.
think even within that, we want to have some idea of what we're.
So what? I guess the question is, Greg, where do we see the savings that gave us the $100,000 available for these two projects, the lighting and the playground, and are those the highest priority that you could think of in terms of the best utilization of those funds, short of just not spending them?
Well, I think the lighting one, we would be giving up a $50,000+ grant, and I think that's well worth it. We do have issues, things like the fire alarm system. The savings that we generated were for projects that we had in our CIP that came under budget, or we made changes on how they were going to be implemented that allowed us for savings. For instance, we carried a certain level of funds for our generator project at the high school. The generator project came in under budget. Some of our roofing projects that we've been doing have come under budget. So those funds still remain in the CIP for this fiscal year. So we will have been looking at how do we take care of some of the things. I mean, the efficiency main grant just came up, literally came on the radar. It's probably, maximum 2 weeks ago when it was rolled out. And literally the window is so small that we have to do a lot of work to try to figure it out. The playground has been an issue for years. And we're trying to come up with a way that we may be able to make our existing playground more safer and kind of take those steps towards doing those improvements. The fire detection system is the system that was designed at Pond Cove Middle School back in 1996. Unfortunately, that's 21 years ago. The standards are very different today. It meets the baseline compliance, but it doesn't meet what we would have for standards today. So it's a bigger project to take a look at and try to figure it out. It does require engineering services, fire marshal approval, and so on and so forth. So it's a larger project that we would be taking a look at and getting some engineering help with that.
But so just to kind of rephrase for John, are these two projects the two that you would put at the top of the list?
I would certainly put the lighting at the top of the list because of the ability to obtain such a large grant. The playground, there are issues on the playground we're going to have to deal with, whether or not the CIP money is utilized for that. The fire detection, as I said, meets the requirements of 1996. It does not meet the requirements of 2017. It is a higher priority item. It's also a very expensive item. So I've got to look at the total costs and where we sit with those type of projects, and how does that fit into our CIP request for next year. It may modify what we're doing with our current CIP requests.
So if we're looking at modifying our current CIP request, would the expenditure that you're proposing tonight on the playground become part of that consideration?
This would be the CIP request for 2018, not 17. It would be next year's fiscal budget, not this year's fiscal budget.
Can you ballpark what a new system at the Poncova Middle School for fire alarm?
I can tell you I just replaced the panel at the high school 2 years ago, and that was $100,000. That was just the panel. That wasn't the whole system. I hesitate to guess a real number off the top of my head because it's a pretty complex figure that we have to work it up for, but it's going to be in the hundreds of thousands of dollars.
And can that be something that can be upgraded in phases as well?
To a point. There are major components that have to be done right off the bat. And there's some requirements as you start a major renovation. The renovation has to be done as a complete package to be able to continue to meet the requirements. But I've got to look deeper into what the real cost is going to be looking like.
But if I could, I just want to focus the conversation back onto the two items that we are kind of considering and discussing.
Clarification. I understand the lighting project and the things related to that. That's pretty clear to me and the urgency of it. Is there urgency around the Pond Cove project right now? And if so, I'd like to understand that urgency.
The fire alarm system?
No. The
playground?
The playground piece.
The playground has had violations for quite some time. Some of them are equipment-based, some of them are layout-based. That does put us out of compliance with federal guidelines. Those are areas that we do need to look at, and we have needed to look at for a long time.
And the proposed first piece of this will address those?
That's why myself and the architect are going to meet to kind of address those first steps that will incorporate in the long program so that we're not going to undo anything that we did and try to move forward with parts of it. Kind of a step. It's be the first step, but a step of many steps to get forward.
I think we'd want to make sure that we're addressing any safety or code violations with this first step.
That would be on my number one, too.
So is there a big impact in delaying the Pond Cove playground decision a month?
There isn't, other than we like to get our projects out to bid in that March time frame so that we can. It takes a while for us to put the specs together, get a bid process, do a pre-walk. So I'd like to have those all in place sooner than later.
This also is an action item later on, so there can be further discussion. I think that the board is happy to hear on that Buildings and Grounds is up and running again, and that things are going through that process. And so we're glad to hear from you and hear from Heather about these discussions and how things are getting vetted and talked about. Mm-hmm. Thanks for bringing it forward.
Great, thank you.
Thanks for also jumping on that grant.
I think we're going to be one of the few school districts that actually are able to put it together. So, thank you.
Thank you, Chris. So we're moving on to item 5B.
Just
And I believe that's Jessica.
Hi. Thanks for the opportunity to talk about this ahead of the budget. The job position that I'm proposing actually will go into effect if approved for the 17-18 school year, but I'm asking for us to look at it ahead of time so we could put the hiring process in place. And the person, if we do go forward with it, can be fully ready to start the position in August. And just to explain why I feel it's okay to do that now, this position, in looking at how we best support students and staff all together, I'm trying to figure out with the resources that we have how to reallocate positions to make sure we're kind of filling in those gaps. This position is completely budget neutral, which is another reason why I feel it's appropriate to put it forward a bit ahead of time of the regular budget proposal. I'd like these people to be able to have access to training, access to some of the other things that as administrators, as they go through just getting some of the language and the, like I said, the training they would use ahead of time. This position actually exists at Pond Cove, just not as intense and as all-encompassing as it will. There's five teaching positions right now at Pond Cove, and one of those teaching positions actually doesn't do a caseload or direct services as the other four do. So this would be reallocating two teacher positions, but one is already kind of taken away from that teaching role. So it would be reassigning one teacher role to more of the support position. We're looking right now at where the student numbers are, and it seems like we would be doing a K-5 or a K-6 distribution, and then a 6-12 or 7-12 distribution based on the where the heaviest load of kids are. The biggest area of target two that I've seen over this year is that we're missing a lot between that transition from 4th to 5th grade and also 8th to 9th grade. So just these people would help to capture some of those missed opportunities as kids transition between schools. Any questions?
Sorry, remedial listening. Could you review for me again the budget neutral aspect and the reallocation of teachers? What are those teacher positions doing now, and how? What value added do we get for reassigning one of those teachers? What aren't we getting already?
So right now, the special educator serves a dual role. They're case managers and they're special educators. And oftentimes, the case manager role takes on a lot more, I think, that we account for. So this position would help do some of those case management duties. They would do the new referral academic assessments take a long time. And right now, that's taking away from student time. We have no direct supervision of ed tech staff because case managers, again, are also special educators, and there isn't time allotted during the day to provide that direct supervision of ed techs, educational technicians in the classroom. We also right now don't have the ability for teachers, special ed teachers, to work with regular ed teachers. So all of these great things and these tools that they're teaching the students in the context of their resource rooms or in a smaller group, there's no time built in for the special educators to relay those tools and strategies to regular ed teachers. So I'm really looking at somebody to help carry over everything that's happening from special ed to regular ed, because the whole point of special ed is to give the kids the services they need so we can fade off and they can become, you know, regular ed students, and then also empower those regular ed teachers to be able to provide the same strategies for students. So it's just a lot of listening to staff and listening to administrators and trying to figure out how we can fill those gaps, what the regular ed teachers are saying, but also the supports that the special ed teachers want. Right now, our caseloads are anywhere between 8 and 12, and even with this reallocation, it's still not going to be close to what the state maximum is. I mean, I think we would average, if I pulled these two caseloads, I think I'm averaging between 13 and 15, even having these two positions in place. So I still think looking at special educators being able to actually educate students, and then also having somebody to support the case management part too.
That was going to be my question. So will you be basically using a special educator in a, hopefully, will you hopefully be using a special mm-hmm. educator next year for this particular position so that his or her caseload will have to be distributed? And then secondarily, so the understanding is that this new position absorbs a lot of that case management work?
The stuff related directly to meetings, so all of the new referrals, which is quite a process,
yeah.
All of the idea is that these people attending IEP meetings that I'm not at would assist with some of the written notices, which are those very long notices following meetings, but basically making sure there's a system of checks and balances from the beginning until the end, in combination with the administrators and the office manager that we have. And it would be a reallocation. The idea is that we would post internally and we would just take two positions, people would apply for it, go through an interview process, but then those current caseloads would be redistributed.
And so what I'm hearing from you is that you feel like this, although the remaining special educators will have a slight increase in their caseload, their actual meeting responsibilities and case management responsibilities should decrease.
That's the intention, and a lot of the other stuff that doesn't get talked about, the conversations, the consult times, the carryover between the related services and the regular classroom. So those are just the pieces with the positions that we have, and in my inability to be everywhere, I just feel like we need somebody who sees the K-12, even if it's two positions, to make sure that we're covering all of our bases.
Is it sort of fair to say it's like, if you have a certain number of students that sort of constitute the caseload,
mm-hmm.
and you're concentrating some activities for that caseload from all those students into these positions, so that while the actual head counts per caseload for special educators may go up, what that actual caseload consists of in terms of work actually goes down and is more manageable.
Correct.
And so you're actually specializing function to get more efficiency. Is that
correct?
Accurate?
And another big part that I failed to mention is that we have the student support team at each of the schools. And what I'd like for this particular position to do is to facilitate those meetings, because if you know, response to intervention, you're supposed to assign students to different tiers based on their need. And right now, we haven't clearly defined what those tiers are, and I really want somebody with a special ed side to understand basically which intervention given this profile of student have the data to make that decision, and then support special ed if it goes beyond a tier three, but also to be able to support those regular ed teachers and whatever RTI looks like next year, to just make sure that people have the ability to reach all of their students. So a big part of them will be data management in every possible aspect, which is how we make our decisions.
So RTI applies to any student, whether they're identified mm-hmm. or on a plan or not on a plan. So these positions, although funded through special education, will work with any students?
Through the SST process, yes.
Okay. Barbara, raise your hand.
I'm glad you asked the RTI piece, because so often that's been shoveled over to general ed
mm-hmm.
without that partnership. So I'm really pleased to hear that you foresee a position where we're really looking at the full spectrum of all kids' needs. And if it goes in the general ed direction, that goes that way. And if after tier three and interventions aren't happening, if it needs to be referred, you've got someone with all that
mm-hmm.
case knowledge. So I really like that.
Mm-hmm. Thanks. Thank you for listening.
Thank you for being willing to share this with us ahead of budget.
Thanks.
Item 5C, the floor is yours.
Thank you. Well, the first thing under my report is to kind of outline for you all the process that we followed in creating the recommendation of a calendar for next school year. And Kathy Stankard was kind enough to kind of put together some bullet points outlining the process and the logic behind the committee and how we got to our recommendation. Would you mind just kind of highlight that for everybody, Kathy?
Not at all, but I'll pull it up.
Oh, I've got a copy. Do you want this?
Yes.
Thank you very much.
I prepared this a little bit of time ago, so. Okay, so as you've mentioned, Howard, the calendar committee, which consisted of administrators and school board members and parents and teachers, met 5 times over a 2-month period to develop this calendar. And all of the various constituencies were surveyed either in person or electronically. So we felt as though we had a very strong sense of how people felt, and calendar is something that people have very strong opinions about. So we had robust conversations in an effort to arrive at something that would please most of the people most of the time. There were some contradictory themes that emerged. There was the desire to minimize the loss of instructional time, while also giving staff the time that they needed to engage in the various initiatives that we are currently mandated to do by the state, or just we feel are important in terms of improving student achievement. So the net result of that, those conversations, then was to put 14 early release afternoons into the calendar to allow for that cross-building collaboration that's so critical. But rather than having them be full early releases that most people are accustomed to, where you have a true half day, we would release an hour before the end of the school day. And that was the compromise that was arrived at. I think people are feeling good about that. Let's see, then there was also the issue around parent-teacher conferences. We considered a wide variety of options and in the end stayed with the current model, which is a half day in the fall followed by a full day. And the full day selected was Election Day, which is a day that we're recommended to close in any case. And then in the spring, there's a little bit more flexibility. There is a half day for those schools that want to take advantage of that time in order to give parents the time that they want to consult with teachers. In the end, we had something we felt good about.
Mm-hmm. The only thing I would add, and thank you for doing that, very
sure.
Appreciate it, is that we understand that no calendar is likely to be fully supported by everybody. I mean, it would be hard to imagine. There are strong feelings about all of this. We also don't think the calendar that is being recommended for adoption is one that can't be touched or modified next year. No, we would expect the next year to again reactivate a calendar committee. It may not be the exact same makeup, but it could be. But the point is, we'll keep building and refining this each year, hoping that we can find time to provide teachers with opportunities to meet, to work on curriculum alignment and proficiency-based education and local school projects and priorities. There's just so much time that we have. It really is, there's not a lot. And so we're just trying to take advantage of that, not have it be so chopped up that it's hard for children or parents with childcare. This, we think, as Kathy said, makes some gains, we think, in the right direction. And we will, I'm sure, be back next year with something a bit different, but hopefully a bit better.
And the only other thing I wanted to mention is that this will take the place of the Professional Development Mondays as well as the Pond Cove early releases, but this provides a much more consistent approach. It's better for staff in that there are 4 more frequent, more regularly spaced meeting times, and in that way I think it's better for parents too. They can plan for it in advance. They either know there are going to be 2 early releases, or in some months because of vacations there'll be 1.
Okay.
always on a Wednesday afternoon.
John?
I wanted to add a couple of things. I really appreciate the work that the calendar committee did. I was not a member of the committee, although I will say I think it's important to recognize the calendar committee does not start with a blank slate of calendar. It has a number of different constraints and things that it has to balance. So it's not that they can just make any changes they want. They've got to make the 183-day teacher contract that we had committed to including professional development within the school day in the contract that we had in a way that was least disruptive. We have to coordinate our calendar with PAS and other regional in terms of which days off and on we have, and as well as balancing all of those concerns. So it's not a blank slate, and it continues to be an evolving process. We made our choices this year. We're going to try and learn from those choices. There was an opportunity to participate at every turn. All of the meetings were published and noticed, and if you want to participate, it was certainly widely available. There were a number of them, and coming up in the future, there will be future opportunities to participate as we evolve the calendar. We understand that not everyone's going to be happy with the results, but it is a constrained decision-making process. Like I said, I'm happy with where we came out. We had to make choices and do the best that we can, and I really appreciate the calendar committee's work and appreciate all of the constraints and inputs that they had to manage.
Thank you. I just wanted to check in with you. You were mentioning the different things that these early release days would be in place of. And if I recall correctly, it will also eliminate the need to have so many substitutes utilized,
correct,
especially at Ponco.
Correct.
So that teachers actually will be in the classroom teaching their students.
More. Yes. Yes. I think we can say that conclusively that will be the case.
That was something that teachers and parents were all excited about. Yeah.
Yes.
And I think that's an important part, because just looking at the schedule the way it is and the calendar, it looks like there's a lot of time coming out of classroom teaching opportunities, but in fact, in some ways, we're adding that by getting the teachers back into the classroom. Mm-hmm. So just to reiterate what Elizabeth was saying. I think that's
absolutely right. I mean, the early releases for professional development equal 14 hours. That's two teacher days, and we have teachers who are having to be released for more than two teacher days in a given year in order to collaborate on curriculum work, et cetera.
Mm-hmm. I wanted to say thank you to the committee also for doing this hard work in a short amount of time. I'm really glad that the direction you're going is to really bring in professional development, because we definitely need to do that. But I'm wondering, this is not a but just, I'm still saying it. Are you going to provide us with an outline of how these half days are going to be used? Like an outline, like how many of them will be working on professional development and K through 12, and how many of them will be school specific, or will they all be?
Yes, we have a K-12 professional development committee, and they will be spending the spring. Once that last early release and professional development Monday has been planned, then we'll be turning our attention to the summer and to next year, and there will be an outline that we could make available to you.
And I would also just like to reiterate that all of these yellow marks, they're not half days.
No.
They're early release days, and it's students getting out of school an hour early, as opposed to what we are used to as being a half day. So just to clarify that and point that out again.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that was an important compromise. Oh, sorry, Barbara.
I was just going to say, from a budgetary standpoint, too, we're not paying for subs and asking teachers to write lessons. The whole thing just works better and more efficiently to get to many of the goals you've described. So thank you for all of that.
Okay. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you
very much, Kathy. So So next, I would just like to announce the names of employees that are either have submitted notice of either their intent to resign or retire at the end of this year. Jean Grant, Nancy Murray, Kathy Walsh, and David Jones have all submitted letters. Tomorrow's the deadline for some kind of benefit that might be spelled out in the contract for giving early notice, so there could be more, but that's what we have as of today. Next thing I want to mention is that, and you may have read about this, the governor announced that he had $3 million in his budget that he wanted to put out to school districts in towns for what he's calling educational efficiencies and opportunity grants. And several districts have been meeting to think about what might we do collectively that would be within the intent of this grant, which has a deadline, I believe, of later this month. It's a very short window. And so have had several meetings with Portland, South Portland, Westbrook, and we believe Scarborough is also interested in joining us. And what we're thinking of is putting together a grant, a planning grant. And the grant would be focused on student transportation and school buses. We currently, well, there's some unique arrangements within these districts, but currently each district is responsible for buying buses, maintaining those buses, hiring drivers, training drivers, designing routes.
Dispatch.
And then you've got dispatch and all the extra runs for sporting events, summer school, transportation. I mean, it's a lot of work. Currently, for Cape Elizabeth, that's one of several jobs that is overseen by Greg Morales. What we wanted to wonder about is, could we work together and perhaps have one place to do mechanical work, maybe one place to dispatch. I mean, like each town used to have its own police dispatch, and now there's a central area in Portland that does that. We think that we might be able to not only save some money, but we also think that we could improve services. It's possible that right now, when we have dispatch, it's kind of roughly, let's just say, 7 o'clock in the morning or 6 o'clock in the morning till 4 in the afternoon. Well, we have buses that are out till late at night. We have buses that are out on weekends. And so when there's a problem, what happens is that Greg gets a phone call or worrying about trips. It's just, there's no one person that can cover all those hours in a normal workday. So we think that it's possible to possibly share drivers, possibly share buses, have one common dispatch, and one place to train drivers and to recruit and so forth, so that we aren't robbing from each other. So what we think that what we need is some group, and there is an individual in the area that, this is what he used to do for the state of Maine, is coordinate all of this, to work with him and his company to try and look at these specific districts and think about where are there efficiencies and possibilities and promising possibilities that the grant would be paying for that work. Then next year, if the grant's approved, we report back to all of our districts, here's what we found, here's some possibilities, and see if we want to then kind of join up and work together. What would happen would be that you would have to obviously receive the grant. I asked if you needed to be approving the grant application, and I was told no. But you would have to obviously vote to, just like, you know, your new policy. So this grant is going to go forward later this month, maybe the 21st, I'm not sure, but it's some date this month. There's a deadline. We've been working on it. Really, Ken Coonan has done the lion's share of work. We really appreciate that. But we think that we've got a good chance, and we'll let you know the outcome of that. So may I go on?
Please.
So a few other things. I'm mindful of the fact that we are going to do our best to have these meetings end by 8:30. I'll try and just shoot through this list quickly, if you don't mind. So just wanted you to know that we have taken out a commitment for a pilot run at a software program called, I guess it's called TeachPoint, which is what we're going to use of the administrators when they go into classrooms to observe teachers, that will be able to be seen for taking notes and can be seen by the teachers at the same time. It's really neat. They can see each and talk, and obviously it's not meant to replace face-to-face meetings, but it's meant to be a way to organize, document, and keep track of all this. So that's something that has happened. I met with Police Chief Williams recently regarding the school resource officer. He is still trying to find out about grants. It may not be until next fall that we know if we're going to be able to apply for one. His interest is really in a school resource officer that would be primarily working at Pond Cove and the middle school. Obviously, it would be in the high school as well, but he would probably hang his hat over at the elementary middle school so that he could begin to build the relationships with children when they're young as opposed to when they're older. So we'll keep you posted about that possibility. Let's see. You've seen the notice from the state about there's some notice that there's uncertainty about when we're going to know what is going to be in our budget for state subsidies to support our school. That's very unfortunate, puts things in limbo, but we're going to right now use current year's figures as a starting point. We should know more along the way. I hope it's not a further cut. It was a major cut last year. I've talked with other districts. They're all kind of doing the same thing. They're going to stick with current year for now and see how it goes. I want you to know about that. She's talking about a $9.5 million cut from general purpose aid, the governor. I did post notice of vacancy today for the position of Director of Teaching and Learning. Remember, Kathy was hired as an interim for 1 year, and I'll be asking for board members to serve on that. I believe I heard earlier that,
Heather and...
Right.
Heather and Kimberly.
Heather and Kimberly.
So I wrote that down.
Yeah, so I would appreciate that. And I'll let you know when we get closer to interview dates. We've had four snow dates so far this year. It's probably higher than the average year. I'm sure it is. Right now, with no more snow dates, we're out on the 21st of June. That's a Wednesday. We certainly don't want to go beyond that Friday and go to another week, the last week. That would not be good. I'm going to ask the administrators to kind of put our heads together, maybe with, I might even ask the calendar committee to be reconvened, because that includes the administrators, some teachers, or some board members, and say, what's our backup plan? Say there are more snow days. I mean, it's a possibility that we would have one or two more. How do we want to make up that those days? I mean, there are several options. I'll
some
explore them tonight.
Yeah.
But we probably want to come back at your March meeting and have that be on the agenda and give you an update of what we think would be our best response. So that may happen. Sorry to say that there have been, in the last couple of days, in the last week or two, we've had four bus accidents. Thank God, none of them serious, no one hurt. I don't want to overstate this. And Greg's on top of it. You may be hearing about it. Who knows? There may be an article about it in the paper. I just don't want you to be surprised. I don't know if there's any more to say than that. Again, I'm not aware of any irresponsible driving. It is what it is. But each of them has been properly to date reported. One came in a little bit late. That's been addressed. And we're just moving forward. So I want you to be aware of those accidents. That's it.
Thanks, Howard.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you.
Moving on to new business, item 6A, may I have a motion, please?
I move we approve the Class 2017 Project Graduation Committee fundraising in excess of $20,000 in accordance with the Board Fundraising Policy DFR.
A second?
Where are we going this year, Jeff?
Not allowed to say. So this part of it is just approving the funds or over a certain threshold. Discussion? All those in favor? Thank you. Moving on to item 6B. May I have a motion, please?
I move we approve the proposed Class of 2017 Project Graduation Trip on Sunday, June 11th, 2017, according to the Board Field Trip Policy IHOA.
Second.
Discussion?
I just feel that we should note that although the trip actually happens officially after they graduate, it is still a school-sponsored trip, so it still falls within our policy. Mm-hmm.
And seniors don't mind snow days because they're going to graduate.
Regardless.
That's right.
Here, here. And so Jeff has fully vetted this trip, although we don't want it to go out widely because this is a nice surprise for our seniors.
Well, it's still under... Is that Molly? Is that Molly Coburn and Mary Ellen Carignan?
Yes.
Couldn't be in safer, better hands.
Thanks, Jeff. Further discussion? All those in favor? Thank you. Item 6C, may I have a motion, please?
I move we approve the 2017-2018 school year calendar.
Second that.
Discussion?
I would just like to thank the calendar committee and all of the representation on that committee for all the hard work that you guys put into that. A lot of thoughtful hard work.
And I'd like to reiterate that we don't believe that there is such a thing as a perfect calendar. We're a work in progress, and we will reconvene next year and hope that people will give input and join the calendar committee and see if we can improve it. All those in favor? Thank you. Item 6D, may I have a motion, please?
I move we approve the 2016-2017 athletic and co-curricular personnel nominations as outlined in our agenda.
I second.
Discussion? I'd like to thank all the teachers and community members and everybody that is willing to serve our students in this capacity. Without your willingness to do this, these teams would not exist. And these are great connections for students to make. So we thank you. All those in favor? Thank you. Item 6E, may I have a motion, please?
I move we appoint Elizabeth Seifries, Susanna Mizell-Hubbs, and Barbara Powers for the school board representatives to the negotiating committee for the Cape Elizabeth Education Administrators Association.
I second. All those in favor? Oh, sorry, I was supposed to ask for discussion. I apologize. Is there any discussion?
I would just like to offer my thank you for the work you're willing to do for that and stepping up.
I'm sorry I steamrolled over that. All those in favor? Thank you. Item 6F, may I have a motion, please?
I move that we approve the superintendent's recommendation for Nate Carpenter, high school assistant principal, for a continuing contract renewal for the 2017-2018 school year.
I second. Discussion? All those in favor? Thank you. Item 6G.
I move we approve the use of the unspent 2016-17 CIP funds not to exceed $55,000 to replace high school lighting fixtures in order to obtain a 50% efficiency main rebate.
Second.
Discussion? All those in favor? Thank you. Item 6H, may I have a motion, please?
I move that we approve the use of unspent 2016-17 CIP funds in order to fund Pond Cove Elementary School playground renovation.
Second.
Discussion? John?
I'm going to suggest that we consider tabling and delaying this for a month until we can get an understanding of how this fits into the priorities that we have for CIP and for other expenditures. It's really a large amount relatively, and I understand the critical nature of the and the advantages of the lighting grant. It's a seven-year payback, $50,000 grant available, makes perfect sense. This one I don't understand the urgency of. I know we want to get our contractors and bids out, but I don't understand what choices we're making between what, and I'm uncomfortable approving it at this time, and I'm suggesting that we consider delaying it.
May I speak to that?
Please.
I don't think there is urgency to move this project forward, so I personally am not at all opposed to postponing this until your March meeting. What I would say, though, is that what Greg is suggesting is that he's telling you that he has around $100,000 in his current year's budget that he had earmarked for one thing or another. He doesn't need all that. He has $100,000 that's kind of available. And if you don't earmark that now for some other project this year, which is just fine, by the way, that would be carried forward. That would be money that would just go forward in your budget as unspent, and then that would lower taxation next year. I mean, that's always a good thing, right? But you can't encumber that, as far as I'm aware of, for next year, or if you can, I'd have to check with your auditor on that. Mm-hmm. In other words, that money isn't just hanging out there. It could be, well, I'll have to find out if you can encumber it. I don't know if you can. If the money was approved to be spent this year, then I think you either spend it or it goes to carry forward. Mm-hmm. So that's the thing that I just would want you to know, that if you find out that I think it's one thing to want to be sure that Greg comes back and says, look, I've looked at everything from what I know today. This is what I've got recommended for a total budget for next year for CIP. This is what I think we would cover, and here's why. That is what he needs to do, and he will do it at a budget meeting this winter. But even if the project for next year does not include more work for the playground, What we have now is money that could go toward at least getting that project started. And I think that there's some playground equipment there that has been shown to be unsafe. There's some footing around there that needs to be jackhammered out and removed. There's some structures that ought to be removed. And there's some playgrounds that are positioned in a way that they don't pass inspection because they're so close to an embankment that drops off on one side. And on the backside there's a fence, and they don't pass anyone's test. So that work that needs to be done for safety reasons, it wouldn't be a waste of money, and it would get this project started. That's why you may want to.
So there is some sense of urgency around that part.
That part should be taken care of.
I will be voting to support this move, and when you look at the likelihood of a child being hurt on the playground versus the likelihood of a child not getting out of the cement building for a fire alarm in time, and the likelihood of either one of those things happening, I'm leaning towards somebody getting hurt on the playground is a much more likely outcome. And that doesn't mean that the fire alarm is going to be neglected. I'm hearing that that's work that's forthcoming. The fire alarms work, they're just not integrated, but that doesn't mean it's an impossible situation to help alleviate now that we know that that problem exists. But we do know that the problem on the playground can't be easily alleviated without having to spend these funds to do that.
May I speak?
Please.
Go ahead. I was also going to reiterate that I there are parts of the playground that are unsafe and that need to be dealt with. So it is a top priority. They don't meet code. They're dangerous. They're not fit for all students. There are students that are in wheelchairs that can't even access the playground and sit on the blacktop because there's no swings that are appropriate for them. And that's just not okay. So I do think it's an important project to put at the top of the list for the safety of the students. If you've had conversations with the nurse in Pond Cove and the number of accidents that come through to her from the playground from falling and hurting themselves. Part of that is natural and will happen with kids playing outside and outdoors, but part of it is the structures that we have. And so I will be voting for it as well.
Kimberly?
And I do think it's important to vote on it sooner rather than later.
Yes, I would reiterate a lot of what Heather said I was going to. But if the money can't be encumbered, it's not really an either-or situation. I mean, this money wouldn't necessarily go towards the communication system anyways.
It's this year's money.
It's this year's money, yes. That was what I was trying to get at. Thank you.
So just to be clear, I'm not saying this is a bad project. What I'm saying is I don't understand the trade-offs I'm being asked to make. I don't know what number two, number three, number four, I have no idea what the trade-offs are making. And absent that information, I'm not comfortable approving it. Right. The other one that was presented clearly had urgency, clearly had economic payoff. I can see, there's no question in my mind, that makes sense. There's a short window, there's pays back, there's additional money coming to the table that we're gonna lose if we don't act now. I get it. This one, I have no idea what trade-offs I'm making. I can't vote for it without knowing that.
I'm just going to add that I appreciate, John, your point, and it causes me some pause also. Mostly I'm wondering, like, okay, so the playground this year hasn't changed from last year. I'm just thinking in my head, why didn't we target this before, if it's that urgent to change now? I mean, I'm for fixing it and doing what we need to keep the kids safe out there for sure. But I'm just wondering, how since it's been on, in need of repair supposedly, or not all of a sudden, but for more than a year, why it's just coming to this now, in this situation, like in this sort of last minute, should have been on the budget for last year. Why wasn't it? Anyway?
I would just add that I hear you, but I support it. I feel like it's seed money to get this project going. I'd like to see we'll get a request for some fundraising around it, and that if we don't commit for some initial work and take care of some initial issues. I don't feel like it's going to get rolling. So for that purpose, I'm going to vote tonight to say, yes, let's do this. Let's get it rolling. We have some work to do there.
And I would like to say that I understand that this has been a problem for a while, actually. For a couple of years, it's come to the board's attention. I also appreciate that it's gone through a transparent process through the Buildings and Grounds Committee. There's been some thoughtful collaboration and coordination amongst our facilities department and the resources that we have district-wide in order to address some of the high priority needs. And that's another reason why I do think that now is an appropriate time to at least get the ball rolling.
So although I am in favor of this motion, I have a couple of reservations and may need an amendment to the motion before I would be comfortable voting on it. First of all, I will not vote on this motion unless there's an actual dollar amount attached to it. I've heard the amount of $50,000 tossed around, but without that dollar amount set, I don't believe that it's appropriate for the board to just vote and say, whatever's left over. I think that we need, and so I will be asking for an amendment before we vote. My other reservation, and it's not a reservation, just I need some clarity, is that I understand that there is some possibility of fundraising. It needs to be really clear to the board who is the point person to accept or direct those donated funds. Is that our facilities director? Is that our superintendent? It needs to be really clear who is organizing, receiving, and directing those funds. And so it's not going to keep me from voting on this motion, but I think it's a very important question that needs to be answered. And I think it does lie either with the facilities director or the superintendent, most likely.
Does that fall the same way the fundraising for Project Graduation? So ultimately, we have to vote to say, yes, you may do this. That's what I expect.
I would think so.
Yeah, that's what I'd expect.
And there's a clear who,
right,
and how much and for what.
Right. Mm-hmm.
And one other point, perhaps, is do we want to know that whatever the amount is, whether it's 50,000, is going to be earmarked for that is the things that are not to code or needing to be replaced. So they'll be targeted specifically for the most needed.
Critical.
That's what was discussed when we met last Friday, okay, was that so we would start with things that everyone agrees are safety issues or concerns.
Basically, I'm hearing things that just need to go. And that there's a cost to...
Okay. There's some things that need to go.
So, I remain conflicted. We don't know exactly how much money we're sort of estimating. We don't know what we're actually going to get for that. And we don't know what the choice B is. This is number two on number one on the list. What's number two? If we heard about number two, maybe we might think it was number one. We have no idea. I feel like I'm voting blind for something that we just attached a round number two. We don't know exactly where that's going to take us, and we don't know what the alternatives are.
But no other alternatives have surfaced, and this has been surfacing for years. And
that doesn't mean there aren't any. That means we haven't presented it.
Or we trust our facilities and grounds person to make his recommendation. That's what I'm willing to accept.
And the committee.
And the committee.
Craig, would you feel confident in attaching a dollar amount so that we could make an amendment to this motion?
I've done a general cost analysis on the project already, and we're right around $49,000 and change to meet some of those requirements and do some of these steps forward. So that's been created already. As I said, I'm meeting with probably should have come
to I'm sorry.
Just folks at home.
Right. No one can hear you from there.
From the top.
That's good. I've already done a cost analysis of getting those code areas and making some of these steps forward. I'm also meeting with the architect, as I mentioned before, March 7th, so we can kind of earmark that. Right now, I'm a little over $49,000 worth of repairs and upgrades to meet those requirements. And we would be asking for approximately $50,000. That would allow for the repairs. There's some architectural fees and things like that all have to happen to kind of make it. We've got a stockade fence that has to be replaced and things like that.
So can we put the $50,000 amount
it would
on
not to exceed 50
not on here to be a little clearer?
I would imagine that's part of your motion.
How much do we have left over in CIP?
But you would support that, that number.
Mm-hmm. And does that expend?
There's still some money sitting in the CIP for things that we don't. There's another 50-odd thousand still sitting in there, 48,000.
Is that earmarked or just underspent?
It's underspent, but it's not earmarked at this point.
Are there other projects that have come to your attention that meet some sense of urgency?
Well, I think I'll be approaching you at some point to discuss the fire alarm and the engineering costs, which would be this fiscal year. So we may be requesting those funds to cover the engineering so that we could get that design moving before fiscal 18 starts.
And when you say cover the engineering?
The fees for designing and specifications, I cannot design the fire alarm system.
So you'll be paying for an engineer to do those?
You're paying for an engineering firm, architectural engineering firm.
Okay. So should we re-amend your motion?
Someone would need to amend the motion.
There's still one on the floor.
John?
In the discussion, I was suggesting that the table did not need a motion.
Right, I heard, yeah.
Well, I will move that we amend the motion to read, I move that we approve the use of unspent 2016-17 CIP funds to a maximum of $50,000 in order to fund the Pond Cove Elementary School playground renovation.
I thought the number was 50.
50.
Oh, I heard 55. I'm sorry.
I think it said 50,000.
Yep. Not to exceed 50. So BP.
Thank you.
Who's a second?
I second.
If it's a friendly amendment, I don't believe that we have to vote to accept the amendment.
Was it friendly?
Very friendly.
Okay.
Susanna made the original
offer of the motion.
Yeah, right. Susanna made the original motion, so you can just, if you accept that amendment.
I accept that amendment.
Okay.
I've learned some things about Robert's rules. So that amendment was accepted, so we can vote on the amended motion. Further discussion? All those in favor? All those opposed? Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you, Greg.
So may I answer the question you raised, the point you raised about chaining of approval?
Yeah, that feels really important.
My feeling is that if an individual or a group wanted to make a donation, that they would work out with this plan, not a modified plan, this is the plan, mm-hmm. and they would identify the rock, the tree, the playground structure, whatever, and they'd meet with Greg, assured that there was agreement and they had a good figure. It would come to the superintendent, he or she would have the authority to approve that or not, mm-hmm. to bring it to the school board for ultimate vote.
Mm-hmm. And so as far as fundraising, we're not going to be having any school personnel going out and rallying and fundraising and soliciting funds?
No.
Okay. Mm-hmm. I'm sorry. Sick child at home? Yes, Nurse Taylor, he's very sick. Thank you, Howard. Mm-hmm. And I think the school board will look forward to hearing more about how that will work.
Yep.
Thanks. So, moving on to item 6I, may I have a motion, please?
I move we approve the mock trial team trip to the National High School Mock Trial Tournament in Hartford, Connecticut on May 10th through the 14th, 2017.
I second.
Was that Heather?
Yes.
Just, your voice sounds like Kimberly's. Discussion. Jeff, do you have any quick little, this is yearly, everybody participates, give us a little, yes, yes.
We have the good fortune of being able to send our team to the National Mock Trial, which always happens to be very close, so we know it's going to be less expensive.
Great. Excellent. Is there fundraising that will happen?
Yes, it's already started.
Thank you. Further discussion? All those in favor? Thank you. Item 6J, may I have a motion, please?
I move we approve the Cape Elizabeth High School Program of Studies 2017-2018.
Second.
Discussion?
May I just say, this is an annual event for you all to approve the course of study. There has been, it was brought up at your last workshop about some possible amendments to, I believe, the math curriculum at the high school, but it really impacts middle school as well, obviously it could. And that is a discussion for your workshop on the 28th of this month. The whole, the sequence and the thinking about some possible adjustments to math program, middle high school. And that, am I right? That's
of March, of next month.
Oh, 28th of March, I'm sorry, I said February. I'm sorry, March, 28th of
for
March.
For the math.
Math.
Workshop.
Right. And so this course of study tonight reflects what is being recommended, correct, Jeff? And we understand that we still need to be sure that you understand and support those changes, and we aren't making any assumptions that you will always automatically agree with the changes that are being recommended. But Jeff really needs to get this out in front of students in order to sign up for classes, in order to assign teachers and get planning and set up for next school year, and to wait until after the 28th of March, just putting him behind the eight ball. Is that correct?
That's right. Would it be possible to just make a couple of... I just noticed today, when I was going over this before the board meeting, that one of the changes that we were going to make, if they did, I didn't catch it until today, so there was a slightly revised version of the program studies. There's only one change, but I'll tell you what it is.
Thank you.
Thanks, Deb.
Thank you very much.
Ooh, this one's a color.
So the only change here has to do with the location within the program of studies of the alternative pathways material, which is a question that the board asked the last time, and it wasn't forgotten, but I didn't catch that it hadn't been made until today. So now, in the last time the board saw this, the alternative pathways material was within the first few pages, sort of within the general introductory information and not with the courses themselves. So now that information appears on page 14, just before the description of all of the other courses, beginning with English shortly after that. So in case anybody had any questions about what happened to that, that would just inadvertently got missed. So I wanted you to see that. I will also say, if I can just add as well, in terms of the math issue, there is nothing in this program of studies, there are no new math courses described in the program of studies at all. There is essentially no impact, particularly in terms of 8th into 9th grade next year. There will be no difference about anything. There is only one page in the program of studies that even touches upon the possibility of a new math sequence, and that's on page 12, where English, foreign language, math, social studies, and science sequences are all laid out. So if you will look at that under math, on the second line, the only thing that's different from anything that anybody picking up the program of studies for the last several years would not have seen is it goes algebra, advanced algebra, and then it references a new course, which, because it wouldn't exist next year, because it doesn't, just because of the sequence, it doesn't affect anybody until 2 years out. That's the only new thing, but that course is not even described. So we wanted to mention it, that that's a possibility, but there is plenty of time to revise that, discuss that on the 28th, because it doesn't affect course scheduling in any way or course signups in any way at this point.
Quick question.
Yes.
I appreciate the rearrangement of alternative pathways up front. I thought it was going to be put in the actual course listing on page 13.
Uh,
given that that's sort of an overview of all courses available?
That would make sense. I didn't remember hearing that the last time. It might have been said. We can easily make that change.
I think that would be great.
Yeah, that's simple.
So you mentioned the new course. Are there any courses or levels of courses that you've chosen to get rid of?
No. The only thing that I would say, I'm not sure if Algebra Part 1 and Algebra Part 2 were in last year's program of studies. That was a discussion last year before the board about no longer continuing with those particular classes. So I think the program of studies may have caught up with that change, but it's not new for next year. And there is nothing else. I mean, it's all the courses are advanced algebra, algebra, geometry, FST is in there, AP stats, pre-calculus, calculus. They're all the same as you've seen before. Mm-hmm.
At the college prep level, at the honors level, at the
best. Yep, okay. Yep. It's all the same.
This is probably for the March 28th conversation about math, but what I'm looking forward to hearing about is if the middle school in the future is discouraging such a high percent of eighth graders from taking geometry in eighth grade, and what would be the impact of that? Likely impact in terms of signups and courses, signups for high school going forward. So that right now, my impression is that something like, and you would know the percent, Mike, but I think we have something like, maybe let's just say 40% of eighth graders taking geometries. Is that close?
Two sections.
Pardon me?
Two sections. What's
about? There are two sections. Okay, but if that was,
it's like 40 kids.
So it's about 40 kids.
Mm-hmm. About a third. So if that became if that became one section or a smaller percent. What would that have any change on? Will that have a change on what students sign up for and what would take over 4 years in high school math? I mean, that's probably part of what we'll talk about next month.
Yeah, we need to talk about that because that really isn't represented here.
Yeah,
that's represented in the first line. Geometry is a freshman.
Students would then.
Those are students taking geometry as eighth graders.
They would then take geometry in the ninth grade,
which
which has been a fairly standard starting place for many of our students. It's just a slight tweak to the percentages. It actually would move us back to where, I mean, closer to where it had been for quite a few years.
Okay, thank you.
So am I to understand that regardless of whatever curricular changes we may have, the course of study or the courses that we're offering in the high school, as represented from this book, really wouldn't change, just individual students?
There's only two changes, but neither of them would go into effect for next year. So one change has to do with whether for students who begin high school in algebra, whether the following year they take advanced algebra or geometry. Mm-hmm. That's one change, but it's not any new courses at all.
Right.
The second change is the possibility of a course called GeoStats, which would be unique to Cape Elizabeth High School, and it would be for students who started in algebra, then went to advanced algebra, then were to take a semester, essentially a course which introduced kids to the major concepts of geometry, the major concepts of statistics. The purpose of that class would be that to help make sure that the students are prepared as well as we can prepare them for the high stakes, particularly SAT exam, which has rejiggered the content of its course by reducing the amount of geometry and increasing the amount of statistics. So it would be really to put us in line with that. And those are the kinds of things that we would absolutely anticipate having between me and Kathy and math teachers. discuss with the board in as much depth as you'd like to hear about it at the March 28th meeting, but really for course signups for next year, there is not an impact.
Just one question as you get ready for the March. One thing I was sort of wondering is just besides that, well, preparing kids for SATs, is there other reasons for going to a shorter, you know, immersion in geometry and stats? So if we could talk about, not tonight, but if we could talk about that at the time.
Absolutely. Sure.
Thank you.
Thank you. Further discussion? All those in favor?
With the one change.
Thank you.
I won't ask for a new motion.
Item 6K, may I have a motion, please?
So I move we approve the school board policy for second reading, JICK, bullying and cyberbullying prevention, JICKR, bullying and cyberbullying administrative procedure, and JICKE, record of reported bullying incident.
Second.
Discussion.
I would just remind the board that this is a redo of a strong policy that's in place now, but through some recommendations from the state that have been rewritten by MSMA and then later by our attorneys, that this meets some new rigorous reporting requirements, in particular investigations and so forth. And so the language as we presented it to you last time, we continue to propose to be the language where we'd like to land. There was some conversation around patterns under bullying that includes, but it's not limited to, a pattern of written, oral, or electronic expression. And we completely agree that in some cases, because it's not limited to patterns, some cases it might be a singular event that would cause an investigation to happen and a bullying situation be taken seriously. But in general, we're looking more at some patterns of behavior that come to the attention of our administrators, our school counselors, and others who are deemed as reporting agents in this policy. So we'd like it to be considered by the board as is.
I really appreciate the policy committee's work on these types of policies. It's really important to the morale and the safety and well-being of our students. That's really good work.
Thank you. It is going to have to pass muster at the state level. They're asking to see what we pass. So the biggest change we made, quite honestly, was combining all those various reporting, investigating instruments through Jeff's help into one flowing document, which we think makes more sense. So if that passes muster, we'll be all set.
Fantastic.
Further discussion? All those in favor? Thank you. Item 7, committee reports.
Policy committee met this evening, and we began reviewing a policy, IJOC, our volunteer policy, and we were really pleased to have John Holdridge join us. He has been our volunteer coordinator going on his second year now, and through his experience had a few recommendations for us. We did not finish that, so we'll take it up again at our next meeting in March.
Thank you. Susanna?
Yep. The CAPE Diversity Group, which is made up of people from the community and the schools and different interested administrators, met, and we will continue to meet once a month. The next meeting is Monday, February 27th at 5 o'clock. I think it will be at 541 Ocean House Road, which is at, it's called Soul at Tamarill Landscaping. And anybody who's interested in coming may attend. And also the Town Comprehensive Planning Committee met. We're in the early stages of sort of tackling how to best
hear from constituents on what they want to be on the next plan. Mm-hmm. So I highly encourage everyone who is interested to pay attention to the future meeting dates. The next one will be Wednesday, March 8th at 7 p.m. in the Jordan Conference Room. And we're going to try to market this committee and solicit a lot of input from people in the next few months so that people are aware that this plan that gets developed really impacts many, many choices. And that from the last plan that was made 10 years ago, roughly 80% of what was in that plan came to be. So it's really a map, a compass for the direction of our town. So it's depending on, you know, what an individual might have as their own priority for their town, I would highly recommend you become a part of it. You know, come to the public meetings and but also in the future for the school to, I look forward to being guided as the school board representative on the committee to see how we want to represent ourselves in these meetings. So, that's it.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Any other committee reports? Not that. Okay. Item 8.
Well, actually, if you want to mention that you're on the working with this, the health committee, and that we're open to
wellness.
Oh, yes. There's a wellness committee, and we are meeting tomorrow morning at 7:30. Where, Howard? Mm-hmm. Do you know where? Yeah.
I do.
You want to share that?
I will. Publicly.
I think so.
For your
it's
own
upstairs
manners.
In the health teacher's room at Pond Cove. You know, you're going down toward the library on the right-hand side.
It, oh, yes.
You have an email sent to you tonight.
Great, thank you. So, up near the library in Pond Cove tomorrow morning at 7:30. So, and it's comprised of a varied group of teachers, people interested in wellness, nurses. Mm-hmm. So, I look forward to being there.
Thank you. Item 8, school board agenda requests. The public should be aware that any school board agenda requests can come in the form of an email or even a phone call, and it doesn't have to happen at this meeting right now. Okay. Item 9, announcements of upcoming meetings. It looks like we've got wellness and comprehensive plan have already been announced. Do we know next policy?
Yes. Policy would meet next on Tuesday, May 7th at 6:30.
May 7th? March.
March. I wrote M-A-R and read it as M-A-Y. Thank you. March 7th.
Mm-hmm.
I don't want any more snow days. See, I pushed this to place to be announced, hopefully right here in the Jordan Conference room again, too. So thank you.
I would like to announce that 2 weeks from now, on Tuesday night, February 28th, I'm sure we'll see most of you there, for our next school board budget workshop. It will be held in the Cape Elizabeth High School Library Learning Commons. It will be videotaped. It starts at 6:30. And our budget background discussions will continue around topics of technology, support systems, and instruction, and a short review of our fabulous budget binder, which we should hopefully receive as budget school board members later this week, so we can take it with us on our school vacation.
Vacation reading.
Absolutely.
And I believe this is correct, Howard, that our next Buildings and Grounds Committee is March 8th at 1:30.
Yeah.
And that will be held in your office. So upstairs in Town Hall in the superintendent's office, mm-hmm. March 8th at 1:30.
Thank you. Moving on to item 10, may I have a motion, please?
I move we adjourn.
Second.
All those in favor? Thank you. We are adjourned.